The Council of Seven Lights by George W. Van Tassel. Publication date 1958. This book is within the public domain. Audiobook format by The Matrix Minds. The Table of Contents. Book Introduction. Chapter 1, The Missing Link. Chapter 2, Invisible Gears. Chapter 3, The Sons of God. Chapter 4, Trinity of Infinity. Chapter 5, Unseen Scales. Chapter 6, The Angels of Space. Chapter 7, Prodigal Mother. Chapter 8, Methuselah's Toy. Chapter 9, The Sword of Damocles. Chapter 10, The False Chariot. Welcome to Chapter 6, The Angels of Space. And the angel that talked with me came again, and waked me, as a man that is wakened out of his sleep. Zechariah Chapter 4, 1. This paragraph fits almost exactly the experience that I had on August 24th of 1953. Angels were always considered by me to be some vaporous type of afterlife that just floated about here and there. My entire concept of things changed with the physically manifested appearance of one of these angels to me. For the position of the full moon, I judged it to be around 2 a.m. Here on the desert, it is nearly as bright in full moonlight as it is in daylight. I awakened, not knowing why, but sensing that something had happened that had disturbed me. We sleep outside about 6 months out of the year, so you can see that our bedroom was readily accessible. As I looked up from the bed, I saw a man standing about 6 feet away from the foot of the bed. This was not uncommon, as we operate a public airport and have been awakened many times by our dogs barking at people coming in during the night. However, at this time not a sound was heard from the dogs. This I recalled later, and it was certainly unusual. I asked the man what he wanted, thinking his so-car might have given him trouble and he had walked into our remote airfield as many others have done before. At the same time, I sat up in bed. Beyond the man, about 100 yards away, hovered a glittering, glowing spaceship, seemingly about 8 feet off the ground. I knew then that he was not having car trouble. The man said, "My name is Solagonda. I would be pleased to show you our craft." My left hand and arm were still under the covers. I pinched my wife in the side to awaken her. Solagonda smiled, like he knew what I was doing. I pinched her again. She normally awakens very easily. I didn't want her to miss what was taking place. Solagonda smiled again. Still no response from my wife, so I pinched her hard. Solagonda nearly laughed aloud. My wife didn't wake up, and somehow I realized Solagonda had her under some kind of control. I hopped out of bed clad only in undershorts. Solagonda preceded me for a few yards, and then I caught up with him and walked beside him. Not a word was said as we walked to the ship. In fact, I never said another word to him. From the time I got out of bed until I returned to it, every time I thought of something to say, he was answering me before I could speak the first word of any sentence. This proved to me the perfect ability to communicate by thought transference. As we approached the craft, I began to get butterflies in my stomach from about 50 feet away. Coming nearer, my hair seemed to want to stand up on end. This feeling disappeared instantly upon entering the ship. The craft was about 36 feet in diameter and about 19 feet high. It looked like the same type that George Adamski photographed in his close-ups. The interior was about 18 feet in diameter and about 10 feet high. The walls were of some opalescent material like our imitation mother of pearl. There was a shelf around the inside below the portholes, about elbow height from the floor when one was standing. A column extended from the ceiling to the floor in the center of the ship. Three other men were on the craft when we went in. They were all of the same approximate height of Solagonda, who was about 5 feet 7 inches tall. These three men smiled but never spoke, and I didn't learn the names. Solagonda demonstrated their retractable seats, which formed a lounge when extended out of the walls. He showed me several celestial navigation instruments, and then we went below the main deck through a manhole into the power generating room. Below the deck, it was necessary to crouch down on a circular catwalk. There the power mechanism was exposed to view, and I understood the principle of operation, which Solagonda apparently picked up by telethought. We left the ship after what I judged to be 20 minutes. Solagonda walked back to bed with me, where my wife was peacefully sleeping. When I climbed back in bed, I wondered if the strange feeling I had had in my stomach was going to affect me in any way. Before I could put the thought into words, Solagonda said, "No, you'll be all right," and instantly disappeared. About a minute later, the ship slipped slowly into the sky and was out of sight in less than a minute. Later, we checked the hovering spot with a magnetic compass. The vortex set up by the field from the ship would swing the needle 10 feet easterly in walking into the vortex center and 5 feet westerly in passing out of the center on the opposite side. People who went there a week later to catch their lunch became nauseated and couldn't eat. I know now that angels are people that come out of space. They not only colonize planets and communicate by thought, but they spend the time helping other people to understand life. Right now they're around and on our planet to help humanity out of the mess we have gotten ourselves into. People are people everywhere in the Creator's universe. The only difference is that most of them have followed the universal laws and thereby progressed, while we on Earth have not. You had a body before you came here on Earth, and you'll have another one when you leave. But maybe then you'll be called an angel. Genesis tells of God making man, but it doesn't say anything about him making angels. This further proved to me that angels are the race of man. The first mention of an angel in the Bible comes in Genesis chapter 16, 7. In this verse, the angel is referred to as an angel of the Lord. The sages of biblical times knew the mysteries and actions of the esoteric laws. Thus, it was known to them that everything that was motivated by natural forces traveled in an arc or curved path. Anything that moved in any other path of motion was unnatural and was symbolically termed an angle. People living in Abram's time therefore referred to anything that was of an unnatural motion from their point of view on the Earth's surface as an angle. These people didn't know anything about weather balloons, modem airplanes, and high-flying jets. The only things they knew of that flew in the sky were winged birds. When they observed a spacecraft, or men come out of the sky, they naturally pictured him with wings, like the birds. Since the appearance of men or ships in the sky was not a naturally happening occurrence, they symbolized the sky visitors as angles. The way these people recorded any happening was to have one of their scribes write it down. Like a newspaper reporter of today who wasn't present at the actual scene, the scribe had to write it as it was described to him by eyewitnesses. Whenever the people wanted a copy of any written record, they found a scribe to copy it for them. The scribes of those days got things twisted as badly as the reporters and newspapers of today do. Due to error in interpreting the symbol, the scribes, in copying the accounts of the angels coming out of the skies, wrote angel instead of angle. All copies made from an erroneous one usually repeated the same mistake. So angels became angels. In a number of the experiences describing contacts with the people in the spacecraft, the Earth people making the contacts stated that the space people disappeared before their eyes. As this also occurred to me during my contact, I can understand their amazement. The uninformed would say they dematerialized. The technically minded people would say they went into the fourth dimension. The psychiatrist would say that the people suffered from hallucinations. None of these are true. The reason our space friends can disappear is because our physical vision depends on light reflection off of things in order to see. The wavelength of visible light extends from approximately 4,000 angstroms, extreme violet, to 7,700 angstroms, extreme red. Compared with the known radiation spectrum as a whole, the range of physical vision is extremely limited. This is comparable to looking at the landscape through a crack between two boards, and saying the landscape outside the range of visibility doesn't exist, has dematerialized, or is a hallucination. Our space friends know light inside out and backwards. In order to eliminate the need for weapons which would injure others, they have developed what they call the perfect defense. This is a small object about 2 by 2 inches square and about 1/2 inch thick. It has rounded corners and is generally carried on a cord around the neck and suspended under the blouse. Their ability to read thoughts allows them to be aware of any danger or threat, and all they have to do is tap this device with either hand, and then appear to disappear. The object is actually a crystal battery that stores piezoelectricity that is generated by cutting magnetic lines of force, or the same as static electricity. The nearest thing to this electricity stored by the crystal battery that we know of we refer to as the spirit body, or aura. The electrical spirit body of people varies with their environment and the chemical makeup of the physical body. This is why you feel good when you are with some people and feel drained or exhausted after association with others. Some people have stronger spirit bodies than others. When the scout ship landed here in August of 1953, I observed this object. Sol Gonda was turning it by the corners between his hands. Suddenly he opened 2 opposite ends of it and pointed it at the granite rocks of the mountain. I saw a pencil lead-sized stream of light between the object and the mountain. I thought he was shooting something near the mountain. Later he explained that he was charging the device. He said they charge various other pieces of their equipment over granite mountains. This is due to the piezoelectric effect set up by quartz in its granite matrix. When they discharge the crystal battery by pressing on either side of it, it releases the charge into their electric body, or aura, and causes light to bend around them, therefore appearing to disappear to the limited physical vision of anyone who is watching them. They do not dematerialize or go into any other dimension. They are just as solid and physical as always, but they are outside of the limits of physical vision. This same device was used by the man Jesus when he disappeared out of crowds of people and again when he reappeared unto the people after 3 days. In Luke chapter 24:13-21, it tells how 2 of the people walked down the road talking with him. Verse 31 says, "And their eyes were opened, and they knew him, and he vanished out of their sight." Some teachings would have you believe that this was a vision the people had. Jesus discounted this himself in Luke chapter 24:36-39 when he said, "Handle me and see, for a spirit hath not flesh and bones, as ye see me have. 2 women shall be grinding together, the one shall be taken, and the other left. 2 men shall be in the field, the one shall be taken, and the other one left." Luke chapter 17:35. Either you have faith in the prophecy of the Bible, or you must reject the whole book. The Bible is an accurate history of events that repeat themselves in cyclic repetition. The above paragraphs say a division of humankind will be made. One shall be taken and one shall be left. Who is to make the decision? Who will do this judging of humanity to see who will be taken and who will be left? Every day that passes, you, individually, are establishing your right to be taken by the way you live. You are manifesting your choice by your actions and thinking. Each person adds increase to their vibratory body aura by conforming to the laws of the universe. Your aura, or the frequency of the body force field, will determine whether you are taken or left. A definite vibration will be established in the force field surrounding each spacecraft that will pick up people. If your body aura or force field conforms with or exceeds the established level of the spacecraft force field, then you can enter the ships. Remember, you are now qualifying or disqualifying yourself to be taken aboard. None can qualify another. Jesus can't save you. Some narrow-minded sects of religious fanatics have established that only 144,000 people will be saved. Of course, they're part of the chosen few. Those who will be taken and those who will be saved are two separate conditions. The next thing one asks is, where will the people who are picked up be taken? This is answered in Luke chapter 17, 37. And they answered and said unto him, Where, Lord? And he said unto them, Wheresoever the body is, thither will the eagles be gathered together. Naturally, the eagles gather together in the sky. This was said in a parable at that time, because the people in the biblical days didn't know what it was to fly in the skies. It was not meant for the people of those days. It was said for the people of our time. The space people angels explained that the people who have been taken aboard the craft in these times were not taken aboard because they were better than anyone else. They explained that these people were taken aboard for their own test purposes, to see how different types of people would react. Each one who has been surrounded was readily accessible in a remote place. They were of cooperative minds, and each represented a different type of the Earth's people. This mass pickup of people will take place prior to the planet's rebalancing on new poles. This cataclysm will wipe out the destructive mammon lovers who will be left on the surface. After the Earth has re-stabilized on its new poles, and the continents and oceans have changed, then the people who have been taken up in the air will be landed back on the surface. Watch ye therefore, and pray always, that ye may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. Luke chapter 21, 36. O man, in the rings established within the light of me, orbiting my systems, I am potency that moves a nebula that causes suns to shine. Though some upon this portion of myself have devious ways to violate my infinite wisdom, it is not I who judge nor pay the price. As in my cycles, as in my phases, as in my eons, I have established precision in the order of my parts. And though a voice comes through to you unrecognized by mortals, realize, in the voice, I am the potent substance force of life, pulsing through your being and to eternity. I separate the white from black and color boundaries that I set, for all my creations are of me, from a lowest animal to tree, and all that is. I am the unseen force that manifests in everything you do. Impotent substance clay of me cannot interfere, except to bring about conditions that reflect upon the garment that you wear. O man, never shall you find an end to me. There is no place I cannot be and am. You make your hell by deeds you do in violation of my ways. One who says hell is a place in my infinity is violating me. Reaction is the only hell, rebounding from a spell when you excluded me, O man. Some preach there is a hell for others, never for themselves. Watch out for these, their ego is leading them astray. Through space and time and place, remember I'm there and here with you. I have no hell for man of me. Man who believes there is a hell is reviving imagery of experiences he has had along the road to me. End of chapter.